play something that reminds me of home for the people who are getting the shit bombed out of them. So this music is inspired by the sound of water in the creek that I grew up next to.
Thank you. Marci, would you like to come up? Marci is my dear friend that used to play music when I lived in Portland, Oregon. You know, they
say, you talk about music from the true vine, well, Marci is it, so.
From the true who?
True vine.
Oh, thank you. So I'm facing Eric right now because, well, we met at a jam in Portland. We'd never seen each other, and none of us had seen each other. It was just Portland musicians trying to make weird shit in the basement. And so we met there, and it was really the first time I'd ever kind of stepped out doing this stuff, just improvising vocally. And it was loud, it was raucous, it was hot doggy, it was lots of language. And Eric, it was wonderful. I mean, we just made this crazy stuff. My name is Clyde, about his dog. You gotta keep me wanting. Lots of language, lots of vamp. And it's been, 8 years since we've seen each other, really?
At least.
And what's been beautiful is that we have both evolved musically to this other place. We both, if I could put my, here we were, and we've both gone out, and now musically we're kind of in this different place, but similar. And it really, the hallmark of it is listening. And so we don't know where we're gonna go. We're just deeply listening to each other and letting the music come from that place and following. And another thing is I see music. So I have to turn away from you and close my eyes. So that's how I listen. So just sharing that. Okay. And I took too big a toke and I'm full of scratchy throat. Thank you.
anymore?
Yes!
Thank you so much, Eric and Marci. That was wonderful. Welcome to A Moveable Beast. And for all the people I sort of see in the back, please, if you'd like to come forward, we got seats up here and you can move chairs around. It won't offend us. You know, if you want to sit together. So thank you so much for coming out. This is the first one of A Moveable Beast of the first year, or of the new year, sorry. And so the next one is going to be on February 17th, so it's here at the same time, same place. And so A Moveable Beast is just, I don't know what it is. It's just sort of a happening where people come together and try shit. And, you know, and if it works, great. If it doesn't, oh well.
And you try. Try again. So a big thanks to Mary Rose and to Lisa Martin, who are paying her rent. And so a big thanks to Steve I for making this place available. And to John and Andrew and all the people here at Soul Culture for making this possible. We're also looking for somebody, if anyone's interested in being part of our very disorganized little crew that puts these things on. We're looking for somebody to be a part of it and help out with everything, but a lot with social media, because I'm really bad at that. I have a negative social media talent. If anyone's interested, please come talk to me. It'd be great. The press that we started up that's actually putting on this event is called Sonorous Anchorite, and it's a little press in town. And we're having an open call for submissions. So anyone who wants to, has a book length manuscript that they're looking to get published, send it in. And you can find it on our website. We have flyers up front. Lisa has a writing group going on at Sabino Canyon, and another one is tomorrow. It happens every month, and it's at 9 a.m. at Sabino Canyon, so talk to her if you're interested. Mm-hmm. You just go out and write in nature and then share, and it's a... She'll talk about it more. I know she's going to share a poem later from her thing. So, yeah, there's a lot of poetry going on in Tucson. The French Festival is happening, which is something really cool. And I don't know all that much about, but I'm going tomorrow. But it'll be really cool. So check that out. Also, Revolutionary Grounds is an open mic on the first of the month, or the first Friday of the month, at the coffee shop, Revolutionary Grounds. And it's really cool, and that's at 5. And POG has its reading series going, and I know that the U of A does too. So I'll check those things out, and that'll be really cool. So we're going to just take a few minutes to make sure and get some movies queued up by both Zoe and Lambert and Desirée, Nicole, Bourret?
Yep.
Bourret? Cool, okay. And we're really, really excited to have those. So get a drink, move the chairs around so you're happy, and we'll see you in a few minutes.
Hello, everyone. My name is Cameron, and I have the pleasure of introducing our two films for the night, our short films. By way of introduction, I am going to read you a quick poem I wrote because I had the esteemed honor of actually getting to work on the set of a different project, not one you're going to see tonight, but a project that was a collaboration between both of the filmmakers that you're going to see tonight. And so I was inspired to write a poem about that experience because just the act of making a film is pretty darn special. So here it is. It's called Many Hands. As usual, you sit inside listening for hours to my mimic of the wind. It takes 6 people to make even an amateur picture move. One to hold the boom like a lure, one to keep flawless count of seam and take while all the rest count stars or freeze until the cut stomach's rumbling. You can just pick up the keys in someone's pocket. Steady waves of traffic crashing in the distance, all drowning out some necessary dialogue, some arc, some theme, some muted denouement. When they say rolling, action, they mean pay more than you make. Gut your precious conscience and throw its hollow body into a cold stream, delicious ritual, tepid fetish, willing sacrifice. Those yellow marigolds no longer look awkward, artificial, stuffed into the frame for a montage. Beside some invincible tuberose. Your mother knows the name of every shrub on set you never bothered to learn. Most likely will never decrypt how to balance a checkbook, but will be brilliant when it comes to banishing shadows. Tonight's key light is lightning. You can see this is going leisurely, nowhere under luminous supervision. And with that, I want to introduce our first film of the night, which I believe is by Zoe Rose Lambert. It is a pretty remarkable project. Zoe, who's always had a passion for sports and athletics, especially women's sports, achieved the honor of following the University of Arizona women's basketball team for a season following then making it to the championship playoffs. And so really got behind the scenes, got to meet the players, become friends with the players. There were players at the screening for this short documentary. And so you're gonna see how remarkable this team is, how remarkable these women are, and how remarkable these athletes are. And she'll really sort about Tucson as well. So I hope you enjoy. Here it is.
Thank you.
gospel thing.
Losing was obviously the biggest low, but it didn't feel like a low because when we came back, everyone was there supporting us.
So I have a relationship with Marshall because we didn't win. And so we wanted to get back there and, you know, we win it all the time.
I feel like this is what this program is. We're always an underdog. Last year, nobody really believed in us. You know, just gets the chip on our shoulder a little bit bigger. And we're going to show up again this year. This is the locker room. It's not really too cute right now. But here's everybody. Obviously, Sam Thomas, everybody's favorite. Lauren Ware, she won a gold medal this year. Taylor Chavez, who's a champion from Oregon, so she got that strap. Shannon Dalton, you know, she helped us in the tournament. Erinette Vonley, her brother plays in the NBA. His name is Noah Vonley. She's also from Oregon, so I'm happy that she came. I had to improve it a little bit. We love to be here. This is my favorite picture in our locker room, though. So Maze's here still. Kate, Darren, Lauren, me, Poyo. Obviously, Ari's not here, sadly.
Mary was top three draft pick. She was amazing. She scored like 30 points a game, whatever. But I think everybody else was like, Mary's gone. There goes Arizona. We're done. But we have other pieces too. We brought in pieces. We have transfers, freshmen. So we're not going to have one person going out there scoring 30 points. This year, we're probably going to have five people all averaging about 10 points a game. It's kind of like the tournament again. We've been through this. No one expects us to be good. We're just going to go out there and show everyone what we can do. And then at the end of the season,
we'll see. The idea, make sure, like, you know, everybody have fun, everybody can involve, everybody feel like they're part of the team. It's just little things that she does with our team that, you know, makes us realize, like, yeah, we're playing basketball, but we're also still kids. And I think that's the type of culture that she brought here. She gets us, you know, she gets us a lot more than other coaches that just get play. Being able to, you know, have a coach that can relate to you, I think it changes a lot, and it's fun to be able to play with somebody like that.
Let me show y'all something else. Here's our practice squad.
we set up with the care. That showed us disrespect, you know.
They gave us swag bags and everything, like, oh, like, this is so cool. Like, they're very thankful, of course. Then you go on social media and see the men got 20 more things, 20 times better. You're like, that doesn't make any sense. All you can do is play your best out there and show why women deserve to be shown on TV and that people should watch.
Wow, David pulls up the next video. I just want to say, welcome home, Brittany Brannon.
Yes.
And if you can't name a WNBA player, they'll work on that. All right, so next up, we got a video by the incredible Desirée Bourret. I'm really honored to be able to introduce this one as well. It is such an important story. It's exploring the opioid crisis, particularly through the lens of our hometown in Tucson, Arizona, and also through the lens of a single family here. So you're gonna see how the opioid crisis really affected a teenager in Tucson. Desirée got some incredible interviews with the teenager's family, and that's all I need to say. Just let the film speak for itself. So please give Desirée a hand.
Together. I would write him letters that he would take to school, and his lunch, he would open it up, and he would get so excited to get those, and then it turned around to where he would start to leave me letters when I would go to work. So these are things, as you can tell, they are dearly loved and folded up because I would carry them with me wherever I would go.
I remember stories of my mom telling me that I would ask for a little brother when I was about 3 years old. So when I finally got one, I was excited. I remember as I get older, it seemed like he wasn't allowed to hang out with us as much because we would do big kid stuff, but I would always try to include him anyways. Always annoying my friends with it.
I first met Dakota when he was probably about 13 years old. He was actually really excited to meet me, and he was just like a whole herd of little BMXers also. So like, we just saw like behind a fence, the tops of like little kids' heads running around a fence, because he was still a kid at the time.
See that? I went firm but slow, because if you go too fast, you might get a little cut. Gotta use the toilet paper, but that's optional.
What do you have those pins? That was a good swipe.
Thanks. I'm a professional shaver.
Actually, you probably will. You're going in for that already?
Uh-huh.
And then those baby hairs all gone?
Kid, you call them baby hairs, you're like, oh my gosh, Dakota. Look how big they are.
I know.
I've known Dakota for probably 12 years. I met his older brother, and we started spending a lot of time together. Dakota just kind of became that annoying little brother to me, too. Just kind of always getting under my skin a little bit and just catching a lot of my attitude most days.
We'd always just have girls around and they were much older than Dakota, so he was always trying to impress them. We always had girls that were 5, 6, 7 years older than him, and Dakota would come up and be like, How's it going?
It's funny, when you raise children and you see, and you raise them to be good boys, they really behave when you're around. And they were. They always wanted to make me proud, and they wanted to do right. They understood right from wrong. It's only when they grow up or that the brothers get old enough, like when Dakota started to be 17, 18, and his brother's in his early 20s, and we'd all get together, that I hear all the things that they did that I had no idea about. And I'm just like, what? You guys did that? I thought you were perfect. I had no idea.
It's a brand new vehicle. It's not brand new. Right?
I gotta keep my eyes on the right model.
When COVID came on the scene, which was also the class of 2020, he was a senior. He did not get to attend a prom. He didn't get to graduate with a class. He actually walked across the stage by himself. And that meant a great deal to the person that he was. I could see it took a toll on him. He was a little bit more withdrawn in his room. He got into music, which I found interesting because he was so scholastic and very physical with sports. So when he got into rap music and wanting to write beats and was listening to SoundCloud rap, I found it such an interesting side to his personality that started to evolve.
I have a recording studio, and he came and asked me and my family if he could use it and start making music with us. I know he was really into Lil Peep. When Lil Peep passed away, I was driving by, and he ran out and said, "Did you hear the news?" And I said, "Who's Lil Peep?" But I think those artists did have an impact on his life. And it's just, they started making very depressing music, and I think it affected a lot of people in a negative way. They want to idolize and emulate what their favorite artists do. And so when you're at that younger age, you just are more prone to just following what they do because you think it's what's popular at the time.
Dakota and I talked about everything. And part of the things that we talked about was he had let me know that fentanyl was out there in some of the drugs because one of the artists that he listened to had actually died of the drug. So March 20th was the day that I got the call, "No parent wants to receive."
I was with my mom and Maddie. We were building a garden in my mom's backyard. Next thing you know, my mom's running into the backyard screaming that Dakota's not breathing. And so he hopped in her vehicle and broke any law you could break on driving. We were rushing to get there.
And upon getting there, I was met by a detective. And her first words to me as I was trying to go up the stairs to the door of his apartment was, "He's gone." Just made a choice that he truly didn't believe would have the outcome that he received. The video.
When he was around, there was only laughter. It's kind of quiet.
Nothing in my life took everything out of me the way that moment did. I've lost friends, I've lost family, but that I've watched him grow up. That just took everything out of me. That crushed me.
I would just love for the world to still know him because he is still bigger than life to me.
Okay, do you have to report it all?
Mm-hmm.
Oh. Yeah, so. Oh. Now what I'm doing.
So I'm going to take just a few minutes, and then we're going to come back with the open mic. So thank you. We'll be back in like 5.
Monsoon, wandering the desert, everywhere saguaros loaded with ripe fruit, ruby gems, glittering ground. Surrounding the elders, creosote and mesquite catch fallen fruit. For easy pickings, the odds were with me. Savoring that sweetness, crunching countless tiny black seeds, saguaro seeds between my teeth, a timeless and ancient thing. Padding along, pluck another honeyed offering, two red melting mouthfuls, grazing desert dawn light tastes on the trail. Pluck a fat brown jojoba seed on a hike, just one to chew on for a while, slightly bitter, lightly nutty, if a sound one can be found. That is good. But this, the towering fruit, scarlet scattered, unusual abundance of it, this season seems decadent. I've wandered into the great hall after last night's drunken feast to find several unmolested slices of pie, cool tankards of mead, no, just the Sonoran desert in full fruit. Relish a third at trail's end, harvest two more, my own bacchanalian bent. Takeout wrapped in my hat, sweetened departing. It appeals to the dumpster diver, the hippie fruit picker, the desert rat in me. Who knew I would be all these things? Grateful for desert fruit and seeds, leaving the birds, bats, tortoise, javelina, and coyote more than enough. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Lisa. Clark Trujillo.
Hello. I'm here with you. I've got a studio next door. I make art, but I wrote poetry in the past few years or so, so it's going to be short and sweet. Probably just one. I titled it Dissolve, and just, I guess I'll read it. To pretend to your gaze, for I had already arrived in this act, outside of your eyes, I disappeared as I wished for your sight to dissolve me, for your fire to purify my heart, so I dissolve, falling into bodies out through hearts. To repair from your gaze in this act, inside of your eyes I can appear when we wished for sight and fire to singe our hearts, for resolve, falling out of body back into light. Pretend I act outside, disappear, I dissolve, your dissolve into hearts. Repair this inside, we fire resolve out of body. I disappear, dissolve, dissolve hearts, this fire of body. And that's how that one went. It was sort of like a cascading subtraction of every word from the previous paragraphs. And a free association from each line, just to kind of cascade and dissolve into something. And this is a picture from a local artist. It's called Fat Cat. And if anybody wants it, I just printed it on my new printer. I was testing it out. Thank you.
Thank you. And so I'm going to close out the open mic this evening with just a little bit from a project I've been working on for about a year. I've probably started it over about a dozen times. And it's called Ebbles, and it's really about art as a kind of close attention. And it turns out that attention is hard, and also it's very mercurial. It changes a lot depending on my mood, which is not what even is in the world these days. So just read a little bit. Wet night, birds song bright, clouds clipped westward, wall, dank shortness overlaying dust. Diminished protocile smell, remains damp. Smiling cement stands in puddle. Mirrored brackish reflection, clouds almost green. As I watch the Roomba vacuum the living room, my sandwich mumbles. When seated on a mat, a fire ant approached. Holding a moment's tension, I crushed the ant with my finger and its thorax folded in on itself before I flipped it from mat to slab. Another fire ant approached, this time along the slab, moving smoothly in a leasing way. It ran into its other and paused, mandibles to fold a thorax. And it didn't move for several seconds. When it did, it moved madly, all straight lines and sharp turns. A minute or two later, the ant returned in its smooth and leasing way and ran into its other again. It paused for a moment, for less than a second, before madly speeding off again in straight lines and sharp turns. The blue is a stew, food for a flow that devours. It's more yellow, perhaps, than blue. Less mellow than blue, the blue is a stew, or rather, the blue is a way of being blue or yellow food. It could be pink. Maybe the stew should just be a stew. It seems to have always been a stew, and colors were never the point of food. That is a stew regardless of the word used. A word is just a word. A word points to while in tension with other words. But the words come after the stew. If the words were to come before, they could only point to themselves. Lost the starling, an afterimage. Liquid shadow hot, just under surface, dark flowering stone. Through wild collisions, the wetness of grass and tooth, mind partitioned and false divides. Would the rot be mangled? Would the rot be mine? Watching the splitting needle, this ever-catching dream, a napping stream, in the space between granite, gravel truthful from secrets held by grove tree. An angel killed for this, all six-string spleen, breaths in and out.
vision, velocity, vice, the evenest milk flowing up the spout, can't be, even for a moment, pulling under, dreaming every knot their thing. Devil passing cinder, vista wafting tone, writing wide and small, pulsing against a splinter spirit raining, gliding to stall. Leaves above clouds, raked into lows, mana clanging loud, broke the arrow tones, allied sky of final lines, the current cry. Cricket season song, snoring parents and dog, a hole in the world. High strung, finger hung, the face poem trance, scratching eye from eye, the penny part drum, sticking words in, never wholly new. Dusty leaves near pods, sun, steel outlier, free or else or. I saw the caterpillar fall, fell so slowly, so unfathomably slowly, hit the brick with a little sound, was green and plump, surrounded by caterpillar shit. I picked it up, held it so it grasped the branch again. It went up. The mid-tone wafts along alabaster boughs, its watery extent, its watery mind. The eagle loom peels this dotted head. Diagonal line and flat hairs, along the hollow end, consecrated notion glue. Pacing and perturbed, pacing and privation, to fill yet unbarred aftermarket scape. Windy water along gravity's falling arc, all breath and burning song, buried under soil and sea. Might not be there, yet seems here. Pelican dips low, speeding ripple tension, reflected motion along vehicle edge. Speck, revolving silence is mended, pixels, blanched seam saturated, vision, umbral gray remainder. Thanks. Now, I have the distinct pleasure of introducing Up Rabbit Mountain. So, do you guys need a minute to set up?
Just a minute.
Just a minute, so take a minute. Thank you.
don't have any poems or films tonight.
Thank you.
shit.
Thank you.
song about a hanging here.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks so much for coming out.
Thank you so much. That's great. So, wow. Well, that's it for what we got tonight. Then please remember the next one is on February 17th at 7 p.m. We got some drinks and some cookies in the back. And maybe next time, Blaine, we'll try and bring a blanket to share or something. So, we'll see you guys. See you guys in a month. Take care. Thank you so much.